that. Who is a third party when it comes to marriage? Who are those third parties?
Marriage is supposed to be for the two.
Okay.
Then family comes in because you no one exists in an oblivion sort of. Everybody belongs to a family.
Yeah, of course.
So when you marry, you came from a family. Both of you came from families. Mm-hmm. But maybe you come together. That's as I said, the instruction is this. Mm-hmm. It said, therefore, the man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one.
One.
He didn't say you cleave to the family. He said you will leave. There's a leaving and a cleaving.
Okay.
Which means that you are leaving them both physically
and mentally,
emotionally. Mm. So if there was so much attachment, when you marry, now that attachment must drift now to your better half.
Okay.
Where you both take decisions together. So I make a statement like, when you marry, both of you must be best of friends. Okay. And it's about both of you first, even before your children come in.
Okay.
Because a couple can marry and children wouldn't be there.
Absolutely.
And about that.
Yeah.
So the most important thing is you are for each other first.
Okay.
So here you are, you have come together. Then today the man's mother is bringing issues up. You're not taking good care of my son. My son, I used to do this for my son. Then what about the woman's mother coming to you? You're not taking good care of my wife, my daughter. How would it be like? So those are the intrusions. Families, friends.
So those are the third parties.
They are the third parties that when you are not very careful with them, you are torn apart.
Okay.
Because whom are you going to listen to? But if both of you have come together, we believe that you are both adults.
Right.
Because marriage is not for babies, it's not for kids, it's not for the immature, it's for the mature.
Right.
So once you have taken that responsibility to come together in this beautiful union, then you must decide to make decisions
on
yourself, on your own, and not allowing the outside intrusions from the third person, that is other people who are not both of you. You are yourselves.
Oh.
Those intrusions.
I think there's a lot of mistakes that some of us have made, and we raise our hands.
And friends,
which friends,
be very careful.
Right.
Some we know grew up with intimate people, so when they be married, they still think they should keep them, and that sometimes creates problems. If your partner is not comfortable with any friend you have before you enter into the relationship, you need to be careful about it.
So you have to drop them.
You have to do that diplomatically.
Okay.
But they should know that now it is not about them, it is about you. That is us, you, the couple, and not them. It must be distinctive, it must be very distinct. You must let them know it.
Wow. Viewers, I don't know which parts of this topic that you stand, but you know, when a topic is or when a discussion is going on like this, we all kind of know where we've gone wrong, and I believe that as we listen to Mommy today, we will put certain things right. And those mother-in-laws listening to me, you need to stay away, because we believe and we know and we respect your position. Sister-in-laws and brother-in-laws who are listening to us today, please just know your position, and then everything will be nice and smooth. And when it's your turn, we will call you in. Amen. Okay, moving on to our next question. How do we protect marriages from third parties? How do we do that?
That depends primarily on the couple.
Okay.
That also I mentioned that they need to be best of friends.
Okay.
And when you come into the family, you both need to work it out for the two families to match as one.
Okay.
I may drift off and use our life as an example to help others.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I'll say that from my side, my mother-in-law is more than my mother.
You are very lucky, mommy.
Likewise, my mother to my So my husband calls my mother his mother in love, not mother in law.
Oh, that's beautiful. That is beautiful.
Mother in love.
Yes, that is beautiful.
We have been able to help both families to know that we are one. And they all, we've set standards and the limits. So they know how far they can go in the marriage. Mm. If you are not able to do that, and most often we always say that the man who is the head of the home must be able to put these things right.
So is the man that's supposed to do this?
Yes, he's supposed to make sure that because he was the one who was giving the instruction, leave and cleave.
Oh God.
He's the head of the home.
So he has
the one that the Lord said, for this reason, the man shall leave his father and mother.
So is the man that's supposed to put these things in place?
Very important.
And then you, the woman, you agree.
Exactly.
Okay. See, so here we have viewers.
Amen. When you come together, you both have to be able to compromise.
Right. Right.
Definitely, you have things that you love and cherish so much. But when you marry, it's no longer about me, I. It is about us. So certain things that, especially when it comes to your family, if you had some close bonding, some of us came from a large family.
Oh yes.
And maybe you entered into a home where the family is just a small, you know, nuclear family, sort of, not too much extended.
Yeah, yeah.
When you get in there, please try as much as possible. Don't let the other, your partner, feel the impact of that extended family too much. You have to know where you draw the line.
Wow.
Thank you, mommy. Must be able to do that.
Wow. Thank you so much. I'm just getting overwhelmed with the information. Now, our next question is, what does the Bible says about third parties in marriage?
Then I said, let no one put asunder.
Okay.
The Bible has even mentioned,
let no one put asunder,
where to the two that the Lord has joined together.
Mm-hmm.
That means that they can be put asunder.
Right.
They can separate. That is, you are trying to separate them. So say, be careful. Woe unto such a person who tries to separate what the Lord has put together. Because if marriage is in the right perspective, marriage is of God and is from God, not from man.
Right.
Marriage was not any human being's initiative.
I get that. Definitely.
It is from God. He's the originator. He's the source. He's the creator.
Yes.
He's the maker.
That's right.
So if he has put together and that marriage is built on that true foundation, then it means that no other person has the right to be able to separate the two.
Wow.
Yeah. Except it is not on that foundation.
So this is a warning to those of us who likes to interfere, because interference just creeps in slowly and it becomes something else. And then you end up putting asunder in somebody's marriage. Viewers, we need to be careful and let the marriage people enjoy their marriage. Now, we want to move on to our next question. How is emotional intelligence impact in marriage?
Amen.
Hey.
So when you talk about emotional intelligence, you're talking about being aware of your emotions.
Okay.
Having control of your emotions.
Right.
Being able to manage it. And also being aware of other people's own, so that you can have a judicious relationship with them. Interpersonal relationship.
Right.
And actually, emotional intelligence is important in every relationship. We don't exist alone. God didn't create us to be self-existent.
Yeah.
God created us to have relationships, because he himself loves relationships.
Right.
That was how he created man
and woman.
Wanted himself, even having fellowship with man, is one sign that God loves relationship for which he created us. So having relationships with other people, not only in marriage, even out, it is important to know your emotions.
Right.
How you feel, your mood, your actions. So we talk about the three C's of emotional intelligence, talking about the consciousness, compassion, and connection.
Yeah.
before you can be able to handle this well, you must be able to handle yours, so that the people or the person you are in the marriage with, you'll be able to know how the person also faces certain situations. Because definitely it's a relationship.
No, yes.
So things will come up.
Absolutely.
Not always sweet. So when they come up, how do you handle it? If you're not able to manage, if you're not even aware of how you react to things, and this boils down to the temperament. If you know your temperament, it helps you to be able to know how to handle, control, and manage your emotions.
Right.
Yes, it helps you greatly.
Wow.
So it's very important when it comes to marriage, so that you know if your partner is the quiet person, you should be able to know that, hey, he wants some quietness.
Quietness. But you see, some of the men are too quiet. Mommy, extremely quiet. You have to pinch them before they talk. And I believe that when a man is too quiet, things go wrong. And then in that case, they'll be saying that the woman is wearing the trousers. That bit, I don't get it.
And so, in here, I normally say that it is not knowing yourselves very well.
Okay.
If you know yourselves well, you realize that whoever you have married was like that before you even got here.
Whoever you marry.
Yes. Like if, for instance, the woman is complaining, my husband is too quiet.
Okay.
Your husband showed this sign before you got into marriage.
Oh dear. So we are back to the beginning.
Exactly.
Oh, I see.
So it's all interrelated. It's connected. So if you saw that this person I wanted to settle down with is too quiet, and I don't think I can handle it, because more you know, you might have the sanguine trait, and sanguines are loud. They are talkatives. Cholerics are not.
No.
So if you have such a person, you always be bored, especially if you have a melancholic. Most often they are moody, and they just want to be by themselves.
So God just made them like that, or they develop it from somewhere.
You see, the negatives of the temperament is as a result of the fall of man.
Right.
The strengths of all the temperaments was the real nature, or the template upon which everybody was created until after the fall. The fall is what brought the weaknesses. So we are what we call spirit control temperaments.
Right.
Where now, as a child of God, the Holy Spirit takes over. And now gives you his fruit, which I call the nature or the temperament of the Holy Spirit. That is how I put it.
Okay.
Because when you have the Holy Spirit, you realize that where you can't control yourself, you control yourself because self-control is there.
Yeah.
Where you're a person, you're always moody. You see, there's so much joy. It is in there, so you'll be happy.
Wow. So, we need the Holy Spirit, basically.
We need Him. We need Him. I believe this is a Christian program.
So oh, yes.
We need to let them know that He's the one we believe in.
This is what we are. Real life talk, that's who we are.
Exactly. So, without Him, it is impossible.
That's right.